wrong, was not along, or was not being practiced when I came up as a young man. I did not see a great deal of discrimination when I came up as a young man. The doors were opening, and individuals were very engaging. And even though I was raised in Inkster, Michigan, which was one of your first pilot African-American suburbs in the continental United States, when I left there and finished up at East Lansing High School, I had some of the most positive experiences in life integrating with Caucasian Americans, who became very friendly and engaged me, and I established many, many friendships with, as well as the professional African Americans at Michigan State and those that I had made acquaintance with in Inkster who had contacts at the same or had contacts at the university. Are you listening to me? But this is simply to say, if you received salvation in those days, 2,000 years ago, you were a servant. You were not to allow that to interfere with your walk with God. If you could be free, you were to get your freedom, secure your freedom, and use it to do the will of who? Now, the church has now become a bastion of entertainment today. And the preachers come in and try to get you to use your gifts to either make money for yourself, or they want to tell you about some prophecy God gave them to make money for them. Because this then has been the focus of many ministries of recent until the collapse of the economy. And this then is why we are in the disposition, in the condition and the disposition that we're in today. We warn you that these times were coming. Many looked at me and said, well, you're prospering. Well, I'm prospering, Sister Betty, because the Lord has blessed me to be placed in a area of ministry and business that just happens to be thriving. Now, this is the whole debate, healthcare. And this is where the focus is, the nationalization of healthcare. And that is the Lord's doing. I had no clue when we pursued this 20 years ago that this was going to be the way that it was. How was I to know? Who was I to know? How would I be able to see 20 years into the future? And that when all was collapsing in the economy, we would yet be in a position up to this point, because who knows what tomorrow may bring. And I'll show you a scripture on that in a moment, that this would be the way that God would take us. But this is what God did for us. And even through the past 20 years, God has always sustained us, because we have sought to do whatever we are doing according to the word, the purpose, and the will of who? I can't hear you. So now, this is what we should be doing. Whatever we're doing, we should be allowing the word of God to be that which is the guide in our life. Now, of course, the Holy Spirit is the guide. I will accept that. The spirit of the leader is in the pastor. I will accept that. And the map, or the light unto our path, and the lamp unto our feet is the what? Is the word. Can the church say amen? And so I will say then, yes, the word of God should be that we use and that we seek instruction from in every decision of our life. And if we do not have that knowledge, then we need to come to Bible class so that whatever it is that God would impart to us concerning his will for our life may be imparted. Because all of us would have to admit that at some time or another, when we've come to assemble ourselves in the house of God, God has spoken specifically to our personal situation. And all of us would have to admit, after God has spoken, when we have been obedient to his instruction, we have come out of the situation all right. Can I get a witness here tonight? You don't seem too enthused. Verse 22, let's see if we can find something to enthuse you. Verse 22, read, for he that is called in the Lord, being a servant, is the Lord's freeman. As far as God is concerned, you're what? You're free. Read. Likewise also, he that is called being free is Christ what? Even though you're free, you're still what? A servant of Christ. So this then is the bottom line. And you should underline that the bottom line is to be a what? A servant of Christ. A free man, yet a servant. A free man, yet a servant. Free because he has made us free from error. Someone said, well, he who the Son of Man sets free is free indeed. Well, this, and this, he said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Not free from sin, because the Corinthian church had plenty of sin in it. And they had been baptized. It is unequivocal, emphatic, that these individuals were baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But they had all kind of sin going on. No, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free from error. Because it is error that one goes into. That sin he's talking about is error. Because once you go in error, if you don't get straightened out from error, you'll never get out of sin. And so many people are baptized and feel and still struggle with sin. But if they don't get the truth, they don't know how to get themselves out of sin. If they are in error, they will continue to be in sin and continue to be in bondage and will never be able to get themselves straightened out in the sight of God. Can the church say amen? And so now, yes, if you're saved, you're the Lord's freeman. You're also Christ's servant. So you're free, yet you're a servant. I'm free, yet I am a servant. I'm free from error. Now, am I out here practicing sin? Not on your life. Am I out here living in sin? Not on your life. And not on my life either. Can we say amen? Somebody say, well, I know you're not on my life. What about yours? Not on mine either. Can the church say hallelujah? But what I'm saying to you is that this is indicative in the book of 1 Corinthians that these people were baptized and filled and they had all kinds of problems. And we just listed just a few of them. All right, verse 23, read, what else? Ye are bought with a price, be ye not servants of men. Now this is a good one. Be ye not what? Now this means we should not be caught up in men's personalities. We are supposed to be serving who? Now we serve God, and in serving God, then we have to then serve each other in this respect. This is what he is saying. You should not be serving men after the flesh, but we serve God, and we serve God through ministry, and we serve each other by ministering to one another. Right now, I'm serving God by serving you, by ministering to you. And as the scripture says in the 9th chapter of 2 Corinthians, without charge. Without charging you or burdening you, saying that you have to pay me to teach the word. You have to pay me to preach. If you cannot pay me X number of dollars, I cannot do this job. This has nothing to do with money. This has everything to do with service. I'll repeat that. This has nothing to do with money. This has everything to do with what? Service. So the money's not an issue. The money has never been an issue. And the money will never be an issue. Because that has nothing to do with what we do. Now, do we need money to minister? Of course we do. Should the members of the body of Christ give tithe and offering? Of course they are supposed to. And if they are saved, they will give their tithe. They will give their offering. And they will not take that which is holy, the Lord's, and sacred for themselves. They just won't do it if they have salvation. If they don't have salvation, they'll steal. They look around, make up some story in their heart and their mind, and they will steal from God. And then, of course, they will have to deal with the consequences that go along with being, as the scripture calls in the 3rd chapter of the book of Malachi, a thief and a robber. But that has nothing to do with what God told me to do. My job is to serve God by feeding the flock of God, taking the oversight, not by constraint, but willingly. Can the church say amen? And then the next scripture says, not for filthy lucre, which means not for money. That is an emphatic scripture in the book of 1 Peter, I believe in chapter number 4 or 5. Not for filthy lucre, not for money, but of a ready mind. This is how we are supposed to do our jobs. And all the people said, that's one job I understand. If I don't understand